This session is a launch of the book is by Ali Akbar Hussain. And William Dalrymple and Raza Rumi are going to discuss that. The session is going to be moderated by Raza Rumi. A brief introduction of people. Raza is a writer and political commentator based in Lahore. He is a contributor to the Friday Times, Daily Times, and he also edits and produces his own online journal, Park Tea House and Lahore Nama. And he's also a self-taught painter. And he's been trained as a lawyer and as economist. So the starting, one more thing, this is going to be a 1 hour long session. I'm going to hand it over to Raza, and he's going to introduce the rest of the authors. We'll have a discussion for 45 minutes. Both authors in their own right. We have a discussion for 45 minutes and a Q&A at the end for 15 minutes. And anybody who wants to meet or talk with the authors or get anything signed, we'll do that at the bookshop or at the author's corner. So please don't ask, we don't do that at the end of the session, so we can start the next session on time. So I'll hand over to Raza now.
Okay, thank you. So let me begin. I think we're already late, so what we're trying to do is that wrap up this session as soon as we can. So it's a rare privilege to be with two great authors, Mr. Ali Akbar Hussain, who wrote this book nearly a decade ago, and it has been reprinted by OUP this year. I mean, he also needs no introduction. He's a very well-known architect and has taught across the globe. And presently, he's associated with the Indus Valley Art School and heads the architecture department. William Dalrymple, of course, as we realized from the star power, needs no introduction. But needless to say, he's been writing for years and now based in India, and has been a journalist, is a historian now, and surely has enriched the whole discourse on history and culture in South Asia. I would just like to say a few words about this lovely book, which I only got 2 days ago. So I've been trying to do a crash course in reading some of the dense text in there, but the process has been rather enjoyable. Overall, I mean, the book, I think William Dalrymple has written a very erudite introduction, and which says a lot. I mean, he concludes by saying that while he was researching for the white Mughals, he came across this book, and I quote him, that he fell on scent in the Islamic garden like a thirsty man who has been wandering for too long in a parched desert. Here was a sort of detailed, researched history that I've been looking for, unquote. And surely the whole concept of Islamic garden has several connotations, and the way the gardens were sort of conceived across the so-called Islamic world have a lot of spiritual and religious associations and meanings. In particular, the whole concept of paradise and the way Mughals introduced that from Delhi, Lahore to Agra. But I think the essential point that Dalrymple has also noted in his introduction is that the regional marginal outside the main Indian throne, Bijapur, Golconda, Dakkani states, etc., have not been really looked at into detail. And this is why this is a very important book, because it sort of changes our understanding of the gardens and the way they have been interpreted across India, and in particular the Deccan states. The book is divided into two sections. First outlines the physical and cultural context and explores the great city of Hyderabad, almost built in the image, and at the same time perhaps as Isfahan, the great Persian city, And the author goes into the whole details on the Qutub Shahi dynasty, etc., which I'm sure he'll talk about, and we'll just go on to that. And then the second part looks at more the qualitative aspects of these gardens, in particular the use of... Okay, can I have the mic? Sorry. My apologies for that. Okay, great. So the qualitative aspect of these gardens and how these gardens use scented plants, materials, and then the book goes on to this really rich and amazing account of horticulture, medicine, botany, and above all, it interprets and translates some of the beautiful Dakini poetry and some Persian and Urdu texts. So, you know, since I started reading it, this couplet has been with me, and I'll first cite it in Urdu. Mere ban ke fan ko ata kar wo aab, mere ban ke fan ko ata kar wo aab, ke har phool hove chashmae pur gulab. I translate from the book, of course, grace my garden with that divine water, so each flower becomes a fount of rose water. And there are several other texts which the author has cited and has interpreted them in terms of the whole conception of these Deccani gardens. I will not take more time, and I would go on to William Dalrymple, and just to say some introductory words about the book, and in particular how you read it while researching for White Mughals, and then we'll go on to the author for a more detailed discussion.
Well, first of all, I'd just like to say how much I admire this book. I found it in a OUP catalog in about 2001, mm-hmm. When I was trying to fill out my historical understanding of the Deccani courts. And one of the most extraordinary shadows in the historiography of South Asia is the way that the Mughals have sucked in all the light and all the scholarship. Everyone in you in this room will be able to give the names of all the great Mughals. You will know their faces. You will know their histories. We've seen Bollywood and Lollywood versions of their stories reproduced over and over again. It's very familiar to any educated person in South Asia. What is forgotten is that so much that we associate with the Mughals was happening in a very similar way at the same time with the then equally magnificent courts of the Deccan. And that there were, across the Deccan, the succession of distinct, slightly different, slightly various courts who were in competition with each other, sometimes in alliance, sometimes in warfare. Some were Hindu, some were Muslim. Most had an extraordinary mixture. And the kind of syncretism which is now uniquely associated with Akbar, was very common in the Deccan in the decades long before Akbar. And you find this coming together of Hindu and Muslim, of Vedic and Sanskritic texts mixing with Arabic and Persian, directly coming from the Middle East, happening long before Akbar in the courts of Gulbarga, Golconda, Bidar, and mixing very strongly with the sort of thing that's going on in Vijayanagara. And in modern historiography, particularly in colonial historiography, and carried on in Naipaul's work, there's always been an image of conflict built up between the Hindu Deccani courts, like Vijayanagara, and the Muslim courts, like Bijapur and Bidar, and so on. What Al-Akbar shows so magnificently in his book is the way that these Deccani influences come together and mingle in this unique place, quite distinct from what's going on simultaneously in the north, and indeed in opposition to what's going on in the north. One image, which in a sense sums up the way this simple image has been, should be complicated, is if you look at the famous image of the surrender of Bijapur to Shah Jahan's troops in the great Padshahnama, now in Windsor Castle. And if you look at that image, you see the Deccani Muslim nobles of Bijapur coming out of the city gates, surrendering their city to the Rajput Hindu conquerors sent south by Shah Jahan. And so you have a Muslim capital surrendering to Rajput troops working for the Mughals, which is why many of the great Deccani paintings and Deccani texts end up in the libraries of Udaipur, Jodhpur, Jaipur, and where you have the influence of Deccani painting reappearing strangely in 18th century Rajasthan. And I have some Deccani paintings which I bought at home, which came from the Udaipur library, which were obviously seized during the conquests of the Deccan by the Mughals using their Rajput troops. So it's a far more complicated and mixed world. Also, the kind of syncretic culture for which Akbar's court at Fatehpur Sikri is famous was happening in a dramatic way in Bijapur. There's a lot of work. I recommend the only other books I've read about the Deccan which have the same depth of research as Sent in the Islamic Garden is the extraordinary art history books by Mark Zabrowski and George Michel, which I highly recommend. The Cambridge history of art, the Deccan volume by George and by Mark Zabrowski is a beautiful piece of writing. It's a model of how well art history can read for a general reader. It's a remarkable volume. And he writes up about one of the most intriguing of all the sultans, who was a contemporary of Akbar, who was Sultan Ibrahim Adil Shah of Bijapur, who gradually gave up wearing jewels and adopted instead the Rudraksha rosary of the Hindu sadhu and assumed the title Jagat Guru, or teacher of the world. In his writings, the Sultan uses highly Sanskritized language to shower equal praise upon Sarasvati and the Prophet Muhammad and the Sufi Saint Jerudaraz of nearby Gulbarga. Perhaps the most astounding passage occurs in the 56th song of his Diwan, where the Sultan more or less describes himself as a Hindu god. He's robed in a saffron-colored dress. His teeth are black and his nails are red. And he loves all. Ibrahim, whose father is Lord Ganesh, whose mother is Sarasvati, has a rosary of crystal round his neck, and an elephant is his vehicle. Wow. So the kind of thing that's going on in the Deccan is every bit as strange and surprising and exotic as the much more famous experiments going on in Fatehpur Sikri. And you have a rich mingling of different influences. But what is so extraordinary about this book, and why I've seized on this book with such enthusiasm and excitement, is that Ali Akbar has really used this source material, which is sitting in libraries in Hyderabad, dusty, unused, neglected libraries. Since you've studied there, I think they've had a major flooding in one of the libraries, and half the text just floated away. And so, I mean, literally it's a rescue archaeology going here, reading these texts, long-forgotten, dusty texts. And you need real perseverance to get into these things. As a Pakistani, it must have been even more difficult for you than it would have been for me. To get into these places, to sit there, to translate this dusty stuff, to get access to it, to charm the archivists, and then to realize the significance of it. And for me, it was a whole new world opening up. Everything that I associated exclusively as being the preserve of the Mughals, paradise gardens, the syncretic culture, turned out to be going on simultaneously in several different centers, in several different ways. And the depth of the research and the extraordinary detail that he provides in Sent in the Islamic Garden brought this forgotten civilization, and it's really not exaggerating to say it is a totally forgotten civilization, to light in a way that no other book except Zabrowski's has done. And I really can't say how pleased I was when I was offered the chance to write the introduction to this, because it very strongly influenced what I was doing in White Mughals, and in many ways took over the book. And I think many people have complained this is too fat, this book. They might have a point. It should have perhaps been put on a diet. But I got so excited by the stuff that I shoved it all in. And maybe in some condition I can produce a slimline Dukan version of or Atkins version of this book without give you back your research, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Dalrymple. That's very generous of you, really. Scent in the Islamic Garden explores the relation between cultural values and landscape expression, and it views that Indo-Islamic gardens in terms of their plant material, essentially scent. The focus on scent, apart from my own interest in the subject, is that it's because most plants in arid and semi-arid regions, including much of the subcontinent, are, can you hear me back there? Okay. Most plants in arid and semi-arid regions, including much of the subcontinent, are aromatic. That's another reason that's, Since a large part of the medieval Islamic world constituted was made up of arid and semi-arid regions, the importance of scent in these gardens is natural and undeniable. Many flowers in the subcontinent open in the evenings for pollination by night flying moths that are attracted to night opening flowers by their fragrances. So a tradition of evening gardens or moonlight gardens existed where the fragrances diffused by tuberose, gardenia, jasmine, and other such white tubular flowers could be enjoyed from a garden pavilion, perhaps by moonlight. A study about garden scents has to do with the experiential dimension of gardens, but the difficulty is that such an experience is nowhere to be had, since garden planting is essentially irrigation-based, at least in our part of the world, and plants do not survive neglect. So my study of gardens had to be based on literary texts, on gardening texts and medicinal texts, and it relied on the experience of gardens that was recorded in Dakini poetry, especially in Masnavis. I decided to place my investigation of Indo-Islamic gardens in 17th century Deccan, which was the high point of the Adil Shahi and the Qutb Shahi Sultanates. At the time this book was written, some 20 years ago, there was little interest, and I'm sorry, it's a bit dated, this book. I have to apologize, it's not a new book. But anyway, at the time this book was written, there was little interest in the architecture and landscape traditions of the Deccan, although almost everybody had heard about the Taj Mahal and other such gardens that Dalrymple was talking about a little while ago, that everybody's heard about the Mughals and nobody's heard about the Deccan. To me, the Deccan suggested a rich and untapped reservoir of historical materials for a range of disciplinary interactions. And if archaeological evidence seemed scant, this only underlined the need to explore other sources. One of the literary sources on which my book is based is Dakini Urdu, which is a form of old or Qadim Urdu. 17th century Dakini Masnavis in Dakini Urdu are rich in garden description and imagery, but there are few scholars of Dakini literature, and it was difficult attempting to unravel the complicated metaphors of garden and plant. My cousin in Hyderabad, Asad Yazdani, who is the grandson of the archaeologist Ghulam Yazdani, introduced me to Mr. Asar, a Dakini scholar, with whom I read extracts of Dakini poetry. And in Hyderabad's old bookshops, I found an anthology of Quli Qutb Shah's Kuliyat, compiled in 1940 by the late Mohiuddin Qadri Zor, who was one of the earliest scholars of Dakini literature. Quli Qutb Shah, by the way, founded Hyderabad's at the end of the 16th century. And he also was a poet, and he patronized Dakini Urdu as a means of consolidating the Sultanate. So anyway, that's with this introduction, I ventured into Dakini poetry. This book was written in 1994 and first published in 2000. And I should add that it's a product of my doctoral research at the University of Edinburgh, a study that would have remained unpublished if it hadn't been for the encouragement I received from Anne-Marie Schimmel, who was one of my examiners. After its publication, there was a conference on Dakini Gardens at Hyderabad, initiated by Dawood Ali and Emma Flatt of the School of Oriental and African Studies. Dawood Ali, who now heads the University of Pennsylvania's Department of South Asian Studies, went so far as to say that the conference was inspired by my book, which he referred to as a landmark work. He even titled the conference, Fragrance, Light, and Symmetry, Garden Landscapes in the Medieval Deccan. Following the conference in Hyderabad, I received an invitation from one of the participants to help conserve the Gol Gumbaz garden in Bijapur that dates from the 17th century. This very resourceful lady who lives in Bangalore founded a public charitable trust for the conservation of Deccan's heritage and succeeded in persuading the Archaeological Survey of India to excavate parts of the Gol Gumbaz garden to uncover sources of the water supply. She has also proposed that I build local expertise within the Archaeological Survey of India by providing expert advice on the planting of the garden. At the time of the Hyderabad conference, I also received a congratulatory letter from Professor Aditya Bale of the University of Pennsylvania, who invited me to translate with him the famous Dakini Masnavi Gulchan-e-Ishq of Mulla Nusrati. But sadly, Aditya Bale died before we could embark on the project. I did meet him before he died at another conference on the Deccan, this one in 2008 at New York's Metropolitan Museum of Art, called The Art of India's Deccan Sultans, to which I was invited to read a paper by Naveena Heather, who's the curator of the Department of Islamic Art. The symposium papers were published recently by the Metropolitan Museum of Art in a volume entitled Sultans of the South, Arts of India's Deccan Courts, 1323 to 1687. I'd like to also mention that one of the first congratulatory messages I received on the book's first publication came from Mr. Dalrymple. It was quite overwhelming in its praise of the book's subject matter and study sources. So anyway, this was the kind of scholarship that took place in the last 10 years since I wrote the book, and I'm pleased about that. And of course, Mr. Dalrymple's White Mughals is also an excellent example of the scholarship on Deccan. Sent in the Islamic Gardens comprises 6 chapters. 3 of these deal with the study context, the physical and historical geography of the Deccan, the cultural development of 17th century Hyderabad, and the gardens of the Deccan. Each of the remaining 3 chapters deals with a particular area of research. Islamic horticulture is one. Islamic medicine, what we call Yunani medicine, is another. And Dakini Masnavis constitute a 3rd area of research. The challenge was to bridge across these areas of research. Considering that scented plants are the chief ornament of gardens in horticultural texts, that aromatics are the essential component of cardiac drugs in the Yunani system, and that perfume plants form an essential part of garden descriptions illustrating the progress of love in Dakini romances, there were lists of scented plants that inevitably resulted from a review of the related literature. An appraisal of perfumery texts within the Deccan, together with other recipes for the preservation of health, particularly the health of the heart, yielded an extensive list of scented plants, including some such as the Nagkesar, Paidal, Molsri, and Champa, with beautiful showy flowers which brighten the eye and perfume the heart, as a Dakni poet Nusrati wrote in one of his Masnavis. Together, the plants in these lists describe the perfume bouquets or majmuas that permeated Dakni gardens. In terms of Islamic or Yunani medicine, most floral and some animal-based fragrances work to enhance the sensory powers and vis-a-vis heighten one's sensation of pleasure, and one might add the pleasure of being in a garden. By enhancing sensory perception, certain perfume compositions or majmuas were also a cue for amorous pursuits in garden settings, as is suggested by the Itre Noris Chahi, a perfumery text written during Adil Chahi times, which provided recipes for ornamenting a khwabgah in the garden with scent bouquets to assist induction of appropriate mood.
Should I break in there just to say that the level of the level of erotic sophistication, yes. This will sell more books than any shown in the Deccany courts is quite astonishing. And it's in the Deccan that you get the translation of these ancient Hindu erotic texts being translated for the first time into Persian and into Arabic, and retitled. So you get versions of the Kama Sutra and the, I'm going to mispronounce it, Sringara Manjari, retranslated as the Lazat El Nisa, the delights of women.
Thank you.
And these, and just to give you an example of the sort of level, you know, today a young buck might possibly, you know, put on a bit of aftershave and light a scented candle, if the girls are lucky. And maybe a bit of shower gel beforehand. But the kind of level of sophistication of seduction going on in Ali Akbar's Deccany courts, you get, not only do you have all this sort of garden stuff going on and all this outdoor stuff going on and moonlight stuff going on, but you also have detailed instructions, which I'd recommend to you all, on how to, on different levels of scent in the same room, and specifically how to charge a bed sheet with a particular scent. I mean, it's very sophisticated, and it's very detailed.
So just sorry. However scents may have worked, one thing is certain, that response to scents were learned over centuries of association of scents with pleasure-giving and pleasure-awakening sensations, and that the idea of associating fragrance with pleasure, sustained over centuries, was in itself the greatest stimulus for the use of scented plants in the Islamic gardens of the Deccan and more generally in the gardens of India and Pakistan. Thank you.
Maybe taking advantage of your presence, William, maybe get some of the excerpts from White Mughals, which were inspired directly or indirectly by this book.
Would you like to have White Mughals or from the introduction of this book?
No, I think, maybe from the book first, and then from the White Mughals.
Okay. Maybe a little bit from the introduction, which, by any standards, anywhere in the world, the Deccany civilization that reached its most remarkable flowering in 16th century Hyderabad was rich and remarkable. Yet it remains astonishingly little studied. So dominant are the Mughals in the historical memory of South Asia that the different Deccany sultanates have been almost completely forgotten outside a small group of scholars and specialists. Almost all visitors to India visit the Taj Mahal and learn about Shah Jahan, but few visit Bijapur, Bidar, or Golconda, and fewer still read the no less remarkable doings of the Adil Shahi and Qutb Shahi sultans. Yet the Deccan has always been a place apart, quite distinct in character from the rest of South Asia. Just as the arid monochrome wastes of Sindh and Rajasthan have always given their villagers an insatiable thirst for bright primary colors, so the relentless, unchanging Deccan plains seem to have led the Deccanese to value above all the strange, the fantastic, and the otherworldly. This taste appears fully fledged in the 5th century cave paintings of Yakshis and Bodhisattvas at Ajanta, and later the extraordinary rock-cut temples at Ellora. It remained the defining characteristic of Deccani art and architecture, commissioned 1,000 years after Ajanta by a series of remarkable Muslim sultans in centers of high Deccani culture. As Mark Zabrowski put it in his History of Deccani Art, whereas Mughal art has a generous dose of logic and verisimilitude behind the glamour, Deccani art revels in dream and in fantasy. Few Deccani paintings record historical events or realistically portray their subjects as Mughal art does. Nor was there much interest in the joys of the hunt, court ceremonial, or Hindu ritual, favorite Rajasthani theme. Instead, princely portraits predominate, which aim to establish a gently lyrical atmosphere, often of quiet abandon to the joys of love, poetry, or just the perfume of a flower. Moods are established through fantastic colors. We are admitted to a private world of feeling, reflection and reverie, triumph over dramatic action. The same spirit animates Deccani architecture, where fantastical outsized domes swell out of all proportion to the structures which support them, bursting swollen from the drums as if about to break open into flower. Where arabesque stucco work swirls with relentless, almost organic energy. Where the palaces and baths and tombs of the sultans possess what Zabrowski describes as a fantastical Arabian Nights atmosphere. We sense a romantic yearning for the domes and minarets of the Muslim heartland. These Middle Eastern borrowings are the distinguishing elements in the art and architecture and garden traditions of the Deccan Sultanates, as successive Deccani artists, architects, and gardeners looked directly to the heart of the Islamic world, bypassing the experiments of the Mughals to the north, to borrow Islamic elements from the mix, straight from the tile work of the distant Ottomans, the architectural models of Transoxiana. In cities like Bidar, one finds still perfectly intact little fragments of the civilization of Bukhara and Samarkand, melon-ribbed domes that might have happily topped the tomb of Timur himself, fragments of fat tile work, clearly influenced by and sometimes rivals of that of Iznik, even a madrasa that would not look the least out of place on the Maidan of Safavid Isfahan. These Middle Eastern and Persian features are effortlessly combined with a sense of plenty and opulence which defines so much of the art of the Deccan. Water sprays from the fountains, the flowers bend in the breeze, peacocks call from laden mango trees. There is a sense of timelessness and calm about these charmed garden scenes that nothing seems to indicate that the Mughals might at any moment ride into the outskirts and pillage and burn. But these exotic Middle Eastern borrowings are rooted in the rich soil of indigenous Deccani Hindu poetry, art, decoration, and design. Relations between Hindus and Muslims had always been much easier in the Deccan than in the more polarized north. And it had long been a Deccani tradition that every Muslim sultan would have a Hindu chief minister. That syncretism reached an astonishing climax in the culture of the Muslim Deccan. It was transformed by the arrival of tens of thousands of Hindu artists, dancers, musicians, and craftsmen after the fall of Vijayanagara. In view of the remarkable beauty and refinement of the adab of the courts of the Deccan, what is perhaps most remarkable about the historiography of Deccani culture is the relative absence of modern scholarship. Little serious work was being done on any of the Deccani courts before Ali Akbar Hussein, and the Deccani paintings are still regularly misattributed to Mughal or Rajput ateliers. In an age when every minute contour of the historical landscape appears to be rigorously mapped out by a gridiron of PhDs, this gap is all the more remarkable. The Deccan remains a major lacuna. For every book on the Delhi Sultanate, there is 100 on the Mughals. For every book on Hyderabad, there is a shelf on Lucknow. As Michelle noted in the Cambridge History, few scholars, Indian or foreign, have worked extensively in the Deccan. which remains surprisingly unvisited and little explored. In this scholarly desert, Scent in the Islamic Garden is a major landmark.
I have a question before I ask you to read something from your from the text. I mean, how would you differentiate between the Mughal and the Deccani Garden? I mean, if there were any sort of summary features that you could outline, I mean, what makes them so distinctive?
Well, for one, there's not a lot of archaeological evidence of Deccani Gardens. We are still investigating. As I said, one of the gardens in Bijapur is being excavated to determine what the sources of water supply were. There are major differences between there's no such thing as a mausoleum garden with a monument that stands in the middle of the landscape. That is one thing that's singularly absent in the Deccani landscape.
Can you, with garden archaeology, work out from the plant spores and so on what was being planted, or is the archaeology not sophisticated enough?
Not yet, no. But that's why I use mostly poetic texts, because they are very realistic. They describe what seems to me real gardens with real plants, and the plants are indigenous. They're not, the poets don't talk about the gul and bulbul of Persia. They talk more about the coconut trees, and they talk about the supiari and things like that that are local, and the shabbu and the genda rather than the 100-petaled rose.
So, how would some?
Just
a sample of garden.
Maybe some of the erotic stuff.
Well, you said that. So.
Okay, I'll read this one. This is my translation of a. From an extract of a Deccani Masnavi, and it's called the Gulchan-e-Ishq, and it was written by Nusrati in the 17th century, and you can get an idea of what how poets wrote and what their garden imagery consisted of. So Farah Bakhsh, the spring-adorned garden. For the celebration of the native Indian pageant of Holi, spring has set the candles aglow in the flower beds of its garden plots, draping the garden enclosure in bowers. Sorry, I need to get my glasses. Draping the garden enclosure in bowers with fabrics and tapestries woven by flowering climbers, and spreading a velvety canopy of foliage above. Flower-filled and of the greenest green, it is a reflection of the star-filled emerald sky and truly joy-bestowing, which is the meaning of Farah Bakhsh. Farah Bakhsh is woven with light and perfume. Each flower bed of its plants is a brilliant floor spread, whether of African marigold or of globe amaranth, whether made with coxcomb or with the poppy. The slender arching floral stems within each bed, bearing rubies or glowing candles, are images crafted by the jeweler. Among individual flowers that receive focus are the poppy, a ruby idol, its radiance heightened by Missi, the mezua, whose stamens are the brilliance of henna-dyed fingers, the cinnamon jasmine, that intoxicated by its own scent, gazes with the wine-filled eyes of the narcissus, and the basil, which entices the lover with its hyacinth-like curls. The spring garden, in its radiance and perfume, is also the aspect of the heavens. The moonflower scars the breast of the moon. The sunflower is the envy of the sun. The fragrance of the screw pine or the keoda, sent aloft, is a comet with a long tail. The line of cypresses is the line of houris in paradise. In this garden reception, hosted by spring, the birds and bees are the guests and form a male and a female assembly in the garden. The poet describes an apparently localized forest association in terms essentially of colorful fabrics. The female birds wear saris, shawls, and scarves. The golden oriole in yellow silk and brown shawl. The nightingale in black sari with red border, her hair done up in a knot. The red-headed merlin in purple dhandaras. The quail in black, the mena in smoky brown, the starling in red. The jhakar appears with coal-lined eyes. The sandpiper with henna-dyed feet, and the parakeet's lips are stained red with betel leaf. As for the male assembly, the hoopoe shows off a crown. The pigeon sports a white satin shirt. The cockatoo wears a green silk cloak. The peafowl is in green and blue taffeta. The shrikes are in white. The spotted dove in brown. The herons appear like Arabs. And the watchman crow is bundled in dark blanket. In turn, the colors of the birds are coordinated with the fragrances celebrated in the court to create image clusters, and the moon is drawn into the spectacle of spring celebrations. It is the moon, the poet reminds us, which in the early hours of the morning has brought the colors of the flowers with which to scatter and douse the birds and bees, the brilliant red of the poppy for the kusumba, the saffron threads of the saffron crocus for the golden oriole, the sandalwood white of the tuberose for the kubak and kumaria, the distilled chua, which is an ambergris preparation, from the violet for the drone bee and the drongo, and aloes wood incense sticks from willow catkins, ambergris from the basil's curls, and rose water from flower buds. The wind as cupbearer fills the floral cups with wine from the bowl of the sky, and the birds and bees, delighting in the blessings of fruit and flowers, are delirious with happiness as they wander from flower to fruit garden to the brimming pools that are to be found all around the garden. It is love, the poet would have us note, that has brought this harmony among the various levels of God's creation.
So we just have a few minutes before we start the Q&A session. So William, would you like to read something from the White Mughals? A short extract.
Okay. White Mughals was a book which I said I mined heavily on Ali Akbar's scholarship to create the, to populate the courts and to get the images from 18th century Hyderabad. But it's a book which centers on, it's a non-fiction book, but it is a romance about the affair which took place in early 19th century Hyderabad between Khairun Nisa, who was a Nizami princess. Her family were from western Iran, who'd emigrated to Delhi and then found their way down to Hyderabad. And James Achilles Kirkpatrick, who was the Scottish resident in Hyderabad. And what was fascinating about this for me was not that this was unusual, because in one third of the wills in late 18th century India, one third of the East India Company wills, you have the company servants leaving everything either to an Indian woman or an Anglo-Indian child. One third. So one third of the Brits in 18th century India were living in multi-ethnic homes with several different religions and languages permeating their existence. A very different world to our image of colonial society, and a very different world to what it would then be by the time of Kipling in the 1850s. And if you look at the wills, you could actually draw a graph from one in three families being, company servants being involved in an interracial relationship, sufficiently serious for them to be leaving large sums of money in their wills. This is just the ones where you have large sums of money being recorded publicly for going across, so you can escalate upwards from that. From one third in the 1780s, it's down to about one in four by 1800, one in five by 1820, and it's more or less over by 1840. So you have this brief window which is knocked out by the arrival of evangelical Christianity and the arrival of the new aggressive Victorian self-confidence and arrogance which comes with the position of hyperpower status that develops for the British after they conquer Tipu Sultan and get rid of all of their other rivals in South Asia. And what is unique, though, about this relationship is that Kirkpatrick recorded everything in letters to his brother. He wrote once a week to his brother, all the letters survive, and all the intimate and erotic details are there too, but in a very simple cipher. One letter, thankfully, has the number letter code written over the top of it, so we were able to read, if you like, all the dirty bits. And so you actually had, not just the dirty bits, but all the secret stuff that he didn't want anybody else reading is all there, the really personal material. Plus, Kerenisa's family were sufficiently embarrassed by her pregnancy and marriage, because it was a very public affair. In any society today, getting pregnant out of wedlock is a problem. In 18th century Hyderabad, it very nearly resulted in an honor killing. And the grandfather very nearly killed Kerenisa and pulled out his sword, but couldn't quite bring himself to do it. So against this background, one of the uncles writes an extremely detailed book called Tufatul Alam, which I also found in the wonderful bookshops in Hyderabad. So you have both sides of the story, plus you have three investigations from Calcutta where they start interviewing all the members of the family about what exactly happened and how exactly he got her pregnant. It's not an easy thing to do when she's a princess and she's locked up in a harem and he's the British ambassador. It takes a bit of doing this. And so what was fascinating about this story was not that it was unusual, it wasn't. What was unusual was you had the detail. You could actually reconstruct the entire intimate history of this and reconstruct the world, both of the Deccan courts and of this cross-cultural Anglo-Mughal, Anglo-Deccany relationships that were happening at this time. And to summarize the story briefly, she gets pregnant, they eventually manage to get married, he converts to Islam and becomes a sort of spy working for the Nizam, who blackmails him into revealing that he's converted to Islam, threatens to tell Calcutta if he doesn't effectively work a little bit for the Hyderabadis, but he needs no persuasion, because he believes that the Hyderabadis are natural allies of the British, who didn't join the Indian Union until a year later. And it had, at that time, a larger GDP than Belgium. And this entire massive state, which again is forgotten in modern historiography, was a direct result of Kirkpatrick's negotiations with the Nizam and Calcutta, and was heavily influenced by this affair and the pregnancy. So it's a serious piece of political history wrapped up inside this. They get married. Kirkpatrick builds an enormous Palladian mansion of a very similar plan to the White House in Washington as his residency, gets the Nizam to pay for it, and then builds a second palace at the back with a Deccany pleasure garden for his wife, and leads this double life, by day the resident, by night in the night garden, the husband of Kerenisa. And he dresses up in Mughal in Deccany clothes, he wears, he gets into the poetry, does the whole number. But then eventually he decides that he needs to send the kids back to England to be educated. They've been brought up as Persian-speaking Shias. And so they go off back to England. They have their photograph painted by the great artist Chinnery. The picture is up at the moment in the Asia House in London, if ever you were passing through London. And then Kirkpatrick dies. Kerenisa is seduced by a junior assistant at the residency, cast out and dies in disgrace, being allowed back into the residency where she'd once been happy to die at the age of only 21. So it has a very tragic ending. The children who have been sent off back to England are forbidden to correspond with their mother. They are converted to Christianity on arrival, they are baptized, and it's only 30 years later that the daughter walks into a house in the home counties and sees the picture of herself that was painted 30 years earlier up on the wall. And she's walked into the house of the man who seduced and did away with her mother. And she wants to know what's going on. This guy, Henry Russell, who's the villain of the book. And she writes to, gets in the contact in Hyderabad to try and find out what had happened 30 years earlier between her mother and Russell and Kirkpatrick. And in the process, she discovers that her grandmother, who she can still remember, is still alive in a harem in Hyderabad. And I'd just like to read, to conclude, this beautiful letter which she wrote to her grandmother, who she remembered but had not seen for 30 years. And this is her, she's now, she was born Saab Begum in Hyderabad. She was now Kitty Kirkpatrick and living in a villa in Torquay, and an evangelical Christian. But remember, she was eight when she went abroad, and so she has a complete set of childhood memories of this other life. And this memory of her grandmother, who now, 30 years later, she's reconnecting with. And this is the letter she writes to her grandmother, who she hasn't seen in all this time. My dear grandmother, I often think of you and remember you and my dear mother. I often dream that I am with you in India and that I see you both in the room you used to sit in. No day of my life has ever passed without my thinking of my dear mother. I can remember the veranda and the place where the tailors worked and the place at the top of the house where my mother used to let us sit down and slide. When I dream of my mother, I am in such joy to have found her again that I awake, or else am pained in finding that she cannot understand the English that I now speak. I can well recollect her cries when we left her, and I can now see the place where she sat when we parted, and her tearing her long hair. What worlds I would give to possess one lock of that beautiful and much-loved hair. How dreadful to think that so many, many years have passed, when it would have done my heart such good to think that you loved me. And when I long to write to you and tell you these feelings that I have never been able to express, a letter which I'm sure would have been confiscated by my uncle. And now, how wonderful it is, after 35 years, that I'm able for the first time to hear that you think of me and love me, and have perhaps wondered why I did not write to you, and that you have thought me cold and insensible to such near, dear ties. I thank God that he has opened a way for making the feelings of my heart known to you. Will this reach you? And will you care for the letter of your grandchild? My own heart tells me that you will. May God bless you, my own dear grandmother.
Thanks. Okay, anyway, we can take a few questions or observations, comments from the audience for both Ali Akbar and...
Thank you. My question is regarding the sort of preservation of Hyderabad's historical buildings in the... You see, because Hyderabad has suddenly come up as an IT place like Bangalore, and there's a Cyberabad next to it, and I've noticed that all the landmarks, for instance, in Banjara Hills, when you went there, only the name remains. The famous hills are replaced by enormous, multi-storied buildings. So what about the other places, like in the old city or further out, the Qutub Shahi tombs, etc., because, I mean, I haven't been there for a while, so since you visit, what is being done about preserving those? Thank you.
I was very disappointed when I went to Hyderabad. in 1991 and later in 2007. You're quite right, everything has disappeared. The unique moonscape of Hyderabad is all gone now. All the boulders swept away and developers have come in and built houses and huge marriage halls and hotels, and ugly hotels all over the place. So there's nothing that's being done to preserve that. And yes, there's a new IT city that has totally eclipsed Hyderabad. And I don't know if I ought to say this. Perhaps it's because the population of Hyderabad is no longer, the majority is no longer Muslim. And there's a lot of people from the coast, Andhrans from the coast, who comprise the majority of the population, Marwadis and Andhrans. And so the feeling for Hyderabad, for restoring its old grandeur or whatever, conserving the historic architecture, that feeling is no longer there. That response is not there.
I think it's the most destroyed major city in India. And I think there is a reason. The Nizam's kingdom ended badly. The elite prior to independence were not regarded as even-handed in their jurisdiction of their Hindu subjects. And there were massive massacres at the end of Nizami rule. The Nizams rather hopelessly decided to resist the integration in India, then didn't have the weapons to do it. When Operation Polo took place, which was the Indian invasion, sometimes called the police action, the Hyderabad forces were swept away in a matter of minutes. I mean, the Deccani courts resisted Aurangzeb for 20 years, but this lasted one day, the resistance. And there was a strong resentment against the Hyderabad elites. It wasn't just a casual neglect. There was an active destruction and an active will not to remember the past, I think. And the Reddys particularly coming up from Guntur and the coast, these business classes from the... the Muslim elite has to take a measure of responsibility too, as they left. The Nizams, it was very difficult for the courtly rulers anywhere in India, Hindu or Muslim, to preserve their worlds. But several of the Hindu rulers, for example, the modern Maharaj of Jodhpur, has, despite all the legislation aimed against him by Indira Gandhi in the 70s and so on, done an incredible job preserving his culture, keeping himself as the leader of the people. He's still hugely respected and has a major place in society, even though he has no titular role. In contrast, the Nizam went, spent the money, had bad advisors, stuff was frittered away, went off to Australia, remarried several times. Everything was lost. And the elite left. They went off to Dubai, they went off here. The collections were dispersed. And it's a very, very tragic story.
I just wanted to read some lines from from an Urdu poet that Khushwant Singh quoted when he came to give a lecture at Hyderabad's 400th anniversary celebration. I'll read it out in Urdu. The original is, Barbad gulistan karne ko ik shakh pe ullu kafi hai. Har shakh pe ullu baitha ho, anjaam gulistan kya hoga?
Hello. Hi, my name is Heather. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Dalrymple for writing such a lovely book, which opened my eyes as to the history of how the white Mughals really came and what they did. I wanted to ask whether you have any sequel in mind to the book, sort of a postmodern look at what's going on in between the Mughals and the white Mughals today.
No, but there is going to be a movie of it. Ralph Fiennes has bought the movie rights. And we're taking him off down to Hyderabad in April. I hope he's not too disappointed by what's left there. But
please pass the mic there on the left. Yes.
I have a casting clause in the. I don't know. Probably Frida Pinto.
Dr. Ali Akbar, this has been an amazing experience. I know it's an old book, but I think it's relatively fresh even today. And I want to thank you for writing this book, because you're right, Hyderabad has been very, very under exposed to people, and it had a far richer environment than the Mughals did. But then that's my opinion, and I hope some people here can agree with me. Secondly, yes, Hyderabad is going to pieces. I visited there. I saw the Golconda, but then I saw one ray of hope, and that was the Chaumahalla Palace, which has been restored by my good friend and architect Rahul Mehrotra and his friends. And I hope that, you know, they can bring about, because they're more liberal-minded. But sadly, there was no garden around it. And I think it would have added to it if they had, you know, tried to do something with the garden. I want to thank you very much again for writing this beautiful, beautiful book.
Can I just make a comment on that? Although there are no gardens, there's no archaeological evidence, and there are hardly any gardens around, there are some gardens that exist on the rooftops of mosques, old mosques of Hyderabad. And these are some of the old gardens that exist. This is a picture I took when I went to Hyderabad, and it describes the flower buds unfolding on top of a mosque, and that is the... that is the fragrance that comes out from the garden on a rooftop. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Akbar Sahib, this is something about your personal life. Are you a Hyderabadi yourself?
Yes, well, my parents lived in Hyderabad.
The beauty of Hyderabad, when they say...
Sorry, I can't see you. Where are you?
Well, I'm here. Yes. Okay. My name is Dr. Faizal Siddiqui. Uh-huh. And I would like to say that the Hyderabadi language, especially the Urdu language, when they pronounce kaf with khe, when they say katra, pani ka katra, they say pani ka khatra. So that is the beauty of that place, you see. And the baghare began, and the double ka meetha, all these beautiful things. I have not read your book, but have you mentioned all these things? The food of
I've mentioned one Dakini feast, feast, and it's full of the things that you mention. It talks about the piazza, it talks about all of the popular Hyderabadi dishes, and each one is compared to a flower garden.
Wonderful. Then I must read your book to be delicious.
I think we'll have to end now. Thanks a lot. And once again, let's give a big hand to both the authors.
Thanks a lot, everybody, for attending. Thanks to the panel. We are going to be breaking for lunch. So after lunch, the next panel is going to begin. Anybody who wants to meet the authors is requested to do so at the book fair area.